This, the victor's version of history, glamorizes what was actually a dishonorable and dirty war.
When the Christians come, they break everything. They come in summer when it is almost dry. They put it fire. After that, they cut the trees. The agriculture of Al-Andalus was very sophisticated. The more sophisticated is something, the more fragile it is. So the more easy is to break it. Irrigation. If you break a canal, there's no more water. So for some years, people are starving.
So it's a scorched earth policy.
Yes.
Soon, a brutal system of protection rackets emerged.
There is an alternative. You pay me, I don't destroy. I don't burn your house. How much do you give me? I don't cut your trees. How much do you give me? This one, it is a way of the mafia in Chicago. For one century, all the 11th century, all the Christian Spain lives at expense of Muslim Spain.
One by one, the fragmented city-states of Al-Andalus were terrorized. Their solution was to fight fire with fire by bringing in troops from Morocco.
This is the capital from the top of a column in Cordoba. It's a buzzing little scene. You've got four musicians, two who are playing pipes and two who are playing the lute. But at some point, the faces of the musicians have been smashed in.
This wasn't perpetrated by Christian raiders, but by the new Muslim power who had come to help Al-Andalus. The troops who came as military support were strict fundamentalists with a fearsome fighting reputation. They were called the Almoravids.
The Almoravids were a tribe of nomads from the Sahara. They had black skin and wore veils that covered everything apart from their eyes. When they went into battle, they rode light-footed, versatile little horses and took with them camels and elephants. But they were fiercest of all when it came to religion. They preached a return to basic Muslim values, and when they came to Al-Andalus, they were shocked by what they found.
They're people from the desert. It's people newborn to the religion, so they have a hard feeling of it.
Evangelical Islam.
Yeah, absolutely. Not accustomed to civilization.
Yeah. What did they think had gone wrong with Islam here?
They felt they had to purify things. They said, this is people very accustomed to civilization, to science. They're talking with Christians, with Jews. This is a mix that we don't like it. We want purified people.
With the barbaric Christian raiders on one side and these new fundamentalist Muslims on the other, Al-Andalus was crushed. It descended into corruption. A Christian king would provide military aid to a weak Muslim king in return for a substantial payment of gold coin. The whole of Al-Andalus was subjected to this system of extortion. The trouble is, modern Spain chooses to remember this war rather differently. La Reconquista, the Reconquest, is presented as a valiant crusade in which Spain is returned to its rightful Christian owners. This pantomime version of history is personified in many of Spain's national heroes, the greatest of whom is a knight called Guzman el Bueno. Every town in Spain has a street named after Guzman el Bueno. He's one of the country's best-loved historical figures. The story of when Guzman defended the town of Tarifa from Muslim raids is well known in Spain. Guzman's descendants, the Medina Sidonia family, became one of the richest landowners in the country. The Duchess of Medina Sidonia have discovered something remarkable about her illustrious ancestor.
Guzmán el Bueno is the first of the Guzmán family we know about. He is the founder of the family. He came here and lived in this very house. This is a family archive, although it's more than that. It is a rich source of documents from the medieval period and later.
Was it right that one of your ancestors was involved in the Spanish Armada?
The seventh Duke was involved in that campaign. This document dates from 1288. We know my ancestor was in Al-Andalus a year before because he bought a farm, and this document mentions it. It's a permit for him to export 300 bushels of wheat. Look, you can see the word wheat, and what it says is that he is allowed to take this overseas, to where he is from.
Because of the grammar, you can tell that he comes from overseas, not that he was just visiting from overseas.
Yes, probably it refers to a place which was part of Morocco, much larger then than now, a place where neither wheat nor hay could grow.
The Duchess had discovered that her ancestor, the great Christian knight Guzmán el Bueno, was actually a Muslim.
This is really a piece of human history. It dates to 1297. The king refers to Guzmán as my vassal because he is a foreigner.
Guzmán the vassal.
If it wasn't written here, I wouldn't believe it. It was very common for Muslims to ally themselves with Christian factions, especially when Christians were warring with each other.
It must have been quite a surprise to discover that your ancestor was a Muslim.
Yes, a great surprise. This is because there had been a chronicle which dated back to the 16th century, in which the Guzmán family had cleaned up its political and ethnic past. Guzmán was said to have been born in León. They didn't just do this with the Guzmán family, but with all the families that had doubtful ancestors, ancestors of doubtful race. They cleaned it all up. We have a whole load of documents here from the Spanish register, and they turn everything we know about Spanish history upside down. The Spanish are simply inventing history. They have turned history into a fable.
The idea that the Christians and the Muslims were fighting a holy war was created in Spain long after the Reconquest actually took place. Even Spain's most famous hero, the swashbuckling El Cid, is caught up in this fantasy. In films and books, El Cid is celebrated as a kind of Christian pin-up, a crusader in the fight against the terrible Moor. But El Cid spent his life, like El Bueno, as a mercenary, fighting for whomsoever would pay him.
The name Cid means the master in Arabic.